Okay, hello. Very pleasant, and let me first thank the organizers for the opportunity to participate in this bridge. And we are going to speak about Feynman checkers, quantum mechanics on a checkered paper. This is a joint talk with Alexei. I'm going to start, and Alexei is going to continue. Feynman checkers is a very elementary model, and the model can be described quickly. But I can't help discussing the motivation of the model first. So let us start with the motivation. The simplest way to explain what is the model about is a classical double slit experiment. In this experiment, an electron beam is directed towards a plate pierced by two parallel slits. And the beam illuminates a screen placed right behind the plate. If a single slit is open, then the beam illuminates a spot on the screen, as one could expect. See the figure to the top. When we open the second slit, one could expect a larger spot. But in fact, one observes a sequence of dark and bright bands on the screen pattern. You see the realistic experimental pattern in the lower part of the screen. This result shows that electrons behave like a wave. The electron wave passes through both slits simultaneously. And the waves come to a point on the screen with different phases, because the length of the path can be slightly different. And thus, the waves either amplify or cancel each other, which results in a sequence of bright and dark regions in the screen. An interesting version of this experiment emerges if the electrons are put through the slits one after another. If a single electron is emitted, then it illuminates a single spot on the screen, as expected. You see the result on the top part of the figure. But when the electrons are allowed to build up one after another, the same sequence of bright and dark bands emerges. So we see that one cannot at all predict where a particular electron hits the screen. The only quantity we can compute is the probability that the electron hits the screen in a given region. So this interferogram, so-called interferogram, shows that at the brighter regions, the probability to find the electron is larger, and in the darker regions, the probability is smaller. This is an example of some general phenomenon. The Feynman sum over path method to compute such probabilities is to assign certain phases to all possible paths and sum up the resulting waves. And the Feynman checkers model, which we are going to discuss today, is a particularly simple combinatorial rule for those phases for an electron freely moving in one space and one time dimension. Feynman has invented his model in the 40s, but it was published only in 1965 in Feynman's book on quantum mechanics, and there was just a single problem about this model. In that problem, Feynman constructed a function called kernel on a lattice of small step and posed the following problem. Here we quote from the original Feynman-Hibbs book. If the time interval is very long and the average velocity is small, show that the resulting kernel is approximately the same as that for a free particle, except for some exceptional factor. And the solution, the mathematical solution of this problem, is one of the main results of this talk. This problem is solved mathematically for the first time. And this was a short motivation. And now we are going to define the model for the simplest particular case. I hope you enjoy this very visual and very elementary definition. On an infinite checkerboard, a checker moves either upwards right or upwards left. And to each possible path of the checker, we are going to assign a vector in the plane. We do it as follows. Consider a particular path, for example, the one given in the figure, and let us construct the vector. For that purpose, we take a stopwatch which ticks while the checker moves. Initially, the stopwatch hand is directed upwards, and while the checker moves straightly, the direction of the hand is not changed. For example, when the checker makes its first turn, the hand still looks upwards. When the checker makes a second move, the hand still looks upwards. But after the third move, the checker turns, it changes its direction. Each time when the checker changes the direction of movement, we rotate the stopwatch hand through 19 degrees clockwise. The direction of the rotation does not depend on the direction of the turn. Each turn just contributes 15 seconds to the stopwatch direction. When the checker arrives at the final position, we stop the clock and we see at the final direction of the stopwatch hand. For example, for this particular path, the direction of the arrow is right. The final direction of the stopwatch hand is the direction of the desired vector. And the length of the desired vector is just some normalization factor, which we are not going to discuss in detail. It is 1 over 2 to the power t minus 1 half, where t is a total number of moves. For example, for this particular path, this unimportant normalization factor equals 1 half. T equals to 3, and the length of the vector equals to 1 half. So finally, the vector assigned to the initial path is directed right to the right, and it has length 1 half. To make the definition clear, let us briefly compute the vector for another path. We take the following path and we quickly compute the resulting vector. Again, we start with a stopwatch hand looking upwards. It does not change the direction after the first move, but the second move is in another direction. It makes a turn, the checker makes a turn, thus we rotate the arrow, the hand, through 19 degrees. In the next turn, the checker again performs, and the next move, the checker again performs a turn, and again the stopwatch hand rotates through 90 degrees. And after that, we arrive at the final position, we stop the clock, and we look at the final direction of the stopwatch hand. We see that it is directed downwards. This is the direction of our vector. And its length is the same as before, because the number of moves is the same. We arrive at the vector looking downwards of length 1/2. Okay. Now, just one more step to define the model. Now we are going to put a vector into each black square of our infinite checkerboard. For example, let us explain which vector we are going to draw in the square with coordinates 1 and 3. For that purpose, we consider all paths from the origin to the chosen square, starting with the first upwards right move. So, for all of this path, we perform the same procedure as before. We take the vectors assigned to those paths. For example, in this particular situation, we have two paths from the origin to the square 1, 3, starting with the upwards right move. And the vectors assigned to those paths have been just computed. They were computed before, and these were the two vectors looking to the right and looking downwards. And now we take the sum of all the vectors assigned to those paths, and we put the sum of those vectors into the square. This is the vector assigned to the square. We just sum over all paths. For this particular situation, we take the sum of the two paths computed before. As a result, we get a vector looking downwards right of length 1/√2. This is just the diagonal of the square with the sides being the vectors computed in the previous slide. And as the final part of the definition, the length square of the resultant vector is the probability to find an electron in the square with the coordinates x and t if it was emitted from the origin. We denote this number by p of xt. For example, in the situation just considered, the probability to find the electron in the square with the coordinates 1 and 3 is 1/2. It is the length square of the vector computed in the previous slide. Okay, let us summarize this definition, the preceding discussion, in one short formula. The same can be said as follows. Define the vector, or if you wish, the complex number, put in the square with the coordinates x and t, as some normalization factor, 2 to the power 1 minus t 1/2 times I, and times the sum over all paths from the origin to the square xt with the first step to 1/1. And in the sum, we take minus I to the power terms of s, where turns of S is the number of turns in the checker path S. So this is just a short formula which gives a complex number or a vector. This is the same as you wish. It gives a complex number defined geometrically before. For example, if x and t equals to 1 and 3, then our previous computation gives the complex number shown in the slide, looking the downwards right. And let us fix some notation. The length of the square of this complex number is denoted by p of xt, and it is called the probability to find an electron in the square xt if it was emitted from the origin. And we also are going to use the notation a1 and a2 for the real and for the imaginary part of the constructed complex number. So a few comments are in place here. So let us discuss some particular values of this complex numbers and of these probabilities to give an impression of what is going on. We are going to stress the physical meaning of these numbers, but if you wish, you may ignore the physical meaning and just concentrate on the number theoretic properties of these very interesting sequences of numbers. So let us give a few remarks. First of all, a few remarks concerning physics. Optimally, one should think of the coordinate x of the horizontal coordinate as the position of the electron, and the vertical coordinate t should be thought as time. So p of xt is a probability to find the electron at position x at time t. Also, we are going using special units of measurements here. We are working in so-called natural system of units, where the speed of light equals to 1 and the Planck constant also equals to 1. In this special system of units, any motion with the speed of light is represented as a line in the plane OXT parallel to the line X equals to T or X equals to minus T. And we see that by definition, for example, for any square below the line x equals to t, for any such square, there is no checker path from the origin to that square. A checker always moves either upwards right or upwards left, and just cannot access any square below this line. This means that this simple model already respects special relativity. It means that there is no probability to find an electron moving faster than light. All squares accessible to the electron are in an angle line above both lines, x equals to t or x equals to minus t. Let us discuss a few particular values to make the construction even more clear. For example, square 1, 1, let us compute the value here. Clearly, there is only one checker path from the origin to the square 1, 1. The path has no turns. That means that the vector is directed upwards there. It is drawn in the figure. By our convention, the length of this vector is 1, the square of the length is also 1. the probability to find the electron there equals to 1. But notice that the checker cannot access any other square on the horizontal line with t equals to 1. All the other squares have zero probability. All the probability is concentrated in just one square here. Let us come to the next level. For t equals to 2 and for square 2, 2, for that square, we still have only one checker path, and this checker path has no turns. This results in the vector looking upwards, but the length is normalized, and now the length is 1 over square root of 2, and the square of the length is 1 half. So the probability to find the electron here is 1 half. If you look at any other square on the same diagonal, we see that the arrow, the vector, still points upwards, but the length is normalized by a certain factor, and we see a progression of probability, 1 over 4, 1 over 8, and so on. A similar consideration concerns the other diagonal seen here. For example, for the square 0, 2, there is only one checker path from the origin, because we should recall that the first turn is by definition always made to the square 1, 1, that is upright. And then we have nothing to do but change the direction and end in the square 0, 2. This checker path has one turn, and this means that the vector points to the right, and its length is still 1 over divided by square root of 2, and the square of this vector is 1 of 1 half. So we see that there is probability 1 half to find the electron at each of those squares on the second horizontal. And by the same reasoning, we see that the probability to find the electron here in the square minus 1, 3 is 1 over 4. And the probability to find it in the square 1, 3, we have already computed before, it is 1 half. And we see some distribution, probability distribution here. But let us remark that it is not non-trivial at all. This symmetric picture is totally broken when we come to the next level. The probability distribution is not symmetric anymore. We see 1 over 8 here and 5 over 8 here. It is rather complicated probability distribution. So I hope that this figure well illustrates the definition. And now let us just have a look at certain graphs to feel the properties of these numbers. This is how this vectors look for slightly larger values of t. We see waves here, some waves here, and also an interesting phenomenon that at this there is a region, an angle, where the arrows are very short. Let us look further. Let me suggest to look to the plot to the right. This is a contour plot where the color means the probability. The lighter is the color at a particular point, the larger is the probability to find the electron there. The only exception is that white color just represents strong oscillations of probability, the regions where it is very hard to depict any reasonable color. And we see that apparently the electron moves inside certain angle. But this is not the angle above the lines t equals to x and t equals to minus x, as one could expect. No, this is another angle. It was first noticed in a brake screws paper by Ambarinis, Pak, Nayak, Vishwanat, and Watrous in 2001. Those angle is formed by the lines t equals to plus minus square root of 2 times x. Oh, this is not the light cone. This is a different angle. Physically, it means that in this model, with very high probability, the maximal speed of the electron is not the speed of light, but the speed of light divided by square root of 2. Let us also illustrate the same phenomena on the next plot, where we just draw the probability, the real and the imaginary part of our vectors, for some large fixed time. We just take t equals to 1000 and draw the graph as a function of x. And we see that this probability has a sharp peak. It is exactly on the boundary of this angle. And right after the peak, the probability falls to very small values. And notice that those values are small, but still positive. There are checker paths, and there is a probability to find the electron outside the angle for x larger than this peak. But this probability is, by some reason, very small. And the probability becomes exactly zero only when x becomes greater than t, that is greater than 1000. Okay. And now it is a time to not just to show figures, but state some folklore, simple combinatorial results on those probability and those complex numbers. The first result was already seen in the examples before, and this result allows to call these numbers p of x and t probabilities. So it turns out that the numbers p defined before sum up to 1 over all horizontal line. All the following proposition holds. This proposition allows to call these numbers probabilities. Of course, probabilities should sum to 1. And this is why we need that special normalization, which was discussed in the definition. The proposition itself is proved using a recurrence relation for the vectors we have defined. Here is a recurrence relation. Recall that A1 and A2 are the real and the imaginary parts of this complex number A of xt. And this recurrence relation expresses A1 of at sum square through A2 and A1 in a neighboring square with smaller number t. And this neighboring square is just to the bottom right from the initial square. And the second recurrence relation does a similar job. It expresses A2 in a square through A2 and A1 in another diagonal neighbor, now in the diagonal neighbor to the bottom left. And let us give a physical remark. Already this simple combinatorial identity, this simple recurrence relation, has something to do with physics. In fact, this is a discrete analog of the famous Dirac equation. The Dirac equation for an electron moving in one space and one time dimension is recalled in the bottom of the slide. It is just a linear PDE for a function having two components, A1 and A2. And one can see that if the differential operators are replaced by appropriate finite differences here, the mass m is set to 1, and some normalization factor 1 over square root of 2 is added, then the continuous Dirac equations turns into the recurrence relation just discussed.
You see that the probability is a highly oscillating function, but it's possible to find a weak limit for this function, and this limit was known before. This black graph is a graph of our probability, and you see the orange graph is a graph of our weak limit. It's possible to find it explicitly. These two pictures represent the situation for different values of time t. As time t turns to infinity, our function oscillate more frequently, but the weak limit is the same. And it is easy to see that this limiting probability function is not symmetrical. You see the cumulative distribution function. The explicit value of this weak limit is given in the following theorem, which was known before us. It is some tricky function involving arccosine function. And it's also possible to see here that this function behaves differently for the values which are less than 1 over square root of t and for values which absolute value is greater than 1 over square root of t. This observation was made by Kono in 2001. And it is natural to compare this situation with usual one-dimensional random walk. In one-dimensional random walk, the limiting distribution function is a normal distribution, which is symmetrical. But in this case, Kono distribution function is not symmetrical. And it is natural to compare another characteristics. Again, let me remind you that we can consider our path as a graph of random walk. In classical one-dimensional case, the result doesn't depend on the number of turns, and probability to find our electron at time t in some position x is a binomial coefficient normalized by some factor. But when we have our quantum walk, when the result depends on the number of turns, these turns play the crucial role because the result depends on this number of turns. And what we shall have for the quantum random walk? The situation is completely different. We know that for classical random walk, expected deviation is proportional to the square root of t. But for the quantum random walk, typical translation is proportional to t. It is well-known theorem that the probability to come again to the origin, the returning probability, is 1 for classical random walk, but for quantum random walk, it is not a unit. We have a positive probability to fly away from the origin forever. And also possible to consider the following situation. When we have some absorbing point at the coordinate x, when it is known that probability to come back to the origin in classical case is 1 minus 1 over x. It is less than 1. But for quantum random walk, it is curious that probability comes bigger than original probability to come without absorbing point. And then this absorbing points turns to infinity. Again, in classical case, the probability to come back is equal to 1. But for the non-commutative, for our quantum case, this probability is strictly bigger than probability to come back with no absorbing points. And it's possible to find it explicitly. This probability is equal to 1 over square root of 2. So now we know the basic model. Then we have a traditional integer lattice, but it is natural to consider more general situation. Our new setup will be the following. we will consider a rescaled square lattice. We multiply it by some epsilon. Epsilon will be a new lattice step. This epsilon will turn to infinity, to the zero, sorry. And we also will consider the situation when our time t also turns to infinity. And we will consider position x, which are relatively small. So the ratio x over t will turn to the zero. In this more general setup, we have two parameters, epsilon and m, both positive. First parameter, epsilon, is a lattice step, and the second parameter, m, is a mass of our particle, of our electron. And the new definition for this setup is the following. Again, if we want to define our A, amplitude probability, we have to consider all possible paths S from the origin to our point xt. Again, the first step is fixed. We start from the origin and the first step goes to the point epsilon epsilon. And again, the sum of over all these possible paths sums of this form. Again, turns of our path S, they play a crucial role, but the price of each turn is different. For each turn of our particle, we multiply our sum by this number, minus I m epsilon. And again, we define the probability P as an absolute value of our amplitude function squared. And again, we have some normalization factor before our sum. And then this normalization factor has this form. Then we will have that total probability to find electron at some place for a fixed time is equal to 1. As in the basic model. On this picture, you see two situations. On the first picture, you saw this picture before. Our step epsilon is equal to 1, but on the second picture, the lattice step epsilon is smaller. And situation is different. In the first case, the speed of electron was strictly less than speed of light, but on the second picture, the speed of electron is almost equal to the speed of light because our rate goes from zero to the point where x is equal to t. It's also possible to compare different situation when mass differs. On the first picture, you will see the graph of probability when mass is equal to 1. On the second picture, you see probability when mass is 1/2. So it's easy to see that a light particle more moves likely like a light. And this picture turns to the continuous, to the picture corresponding to continuous model. So what is the Feynman's problem? We want to know how this amplitude function behaves when lattice step epsilon turns to the zero, time t turns to infinity, and coordinate is relatively small. So these three parameters turns to the zero. And let me present the main result of our article. What is written here? We assume that mass m is fixed and lattice step is small enough. Time t is also large enough and we are inside appropriate cone. I don't know how to call this cone. It's not a light cone, but probably it's a localization cone. The cone such a cone that the electron can live only inside this cone. And our result is the following. We can prove asymptotic formula for A1 and A2, real and imaginary part of our amplitude probability, with sharp error terms. This formula depends on two functions. The function big A is an amplitude function. It's an even function. You see this even function here. And theta is a phase. It's also possible to write down this phase explicitly. It is clear that this function A1 is an even function. And this square root corresponds to asymmetry. This function is symmetrical, A2 is not, and asymmetry is described by this square root. Here you see the graph of our first graph is a numerical simulation. Second graph is our main term from asymptotic formula, and the difference is quite small. It blows up on the edges of our localization cone, as well as a function. And outside our localization cone, then ratio absolute value of x divided by t is greater and separated from this value, then the probability to find electron outside this cone is relatively small. And if we will come back to original Feynman's problem, we can deduce what was necessary to deduce. And from our theorem follows that it is necessary to assume that these three quantities turn to the zero. And in this case, we will have the following asymptotic formula. Our amplitude function will be proportional to the amplitude function, which correspond to continuous model. And it's also clear from the proof that all these conditions are not only necessary, not only sufficient conditions, but all these conditions are also necessary conditions. So it gives us a possibility to give a correct statement of this problem. And what about methods? The proof consists of two steps. First step is a Fourier transform. We can express our functions A1 and A2 as Fourier integrals. And this result is not new. Something similar was published in the previous papers. Omega P is some strange function, but what is important here that these integrals are highly oscillating integrals. And in number theory, there is a usual method to calculate such integrals. This method is known as stationary phase method. Second step is to apply the following theorem. I took this theorem from the book of Martin Huxley, Area, Lattice Points, and Exponential Sums. What we want to find? We want to find asymptotic formula for the integral of this form. G of p times trigonometric exponent of some function f of p. Function f of p grows, so this function is highly oscillating functions. And we have some conditions on the derivative of the function f on the second, third, and fourth derivative. Also, they have some restrictions on the derivative of the function j. Stationary point is such point in which first derivative of the function f is equal to zero. And in some neighborhood of this point, our function oscillates not so frequently as in another points. And one condition, which is crucial here, that the second derivative must be separated from the zero. And if our function functions J and F satisfy these conditions, then we can write down asymptotic formula for such integral. Gamma is a stationary point, the unique stationary point on our segment from alpha to beta. The first derivative of our function is zero in this point, and our derivative changes the sign. And the formula gives us the main term, the first summand here, some boundary terms, which will be zero for the Fourier integral, and some nice error term. And if we take our functions and calculate all these numbers, then we come to desired result. So additional information you can find in these sources, and our work is published in archive. You can find it using the title of our talk, Feynman checkers towards algorithmic quantum theory. Thank you for your attention.